Believe it or not, I was pregnant for 3 years. Sounds crazy? Well, it's true. My husband and I were always trying for a baby. We desperately wanted one, but I never managed to get pregnant. It was so unfair because all of my brothers and sisters were getting married and having beautiful children, but I was apparently unlucky. My husband and I were so scared we were infertile, but we still had hope. But before I dive in any further, please make sure to like and subscribe and hit that notification bell for more crazy videos like this one. We were considering surrogacy or adoption, but we really wanted a baby of our own, and we couldn't afford to pay for either of those methods. Then one night, I was in the kitchen and I felt something move in my stomach. It felt like a sort of bubbling, churning sensation. It was so surreal. At first, I thought I had eaten something bad or had a stomach bug of some sort, but then I started to think, wait, could this be a baby? Was I pregnant? I didn't want to tell my husband yet because I didn't know for sure, but I was convinced I was pregnant, even before I did the pregnancy test. I rushed to the store, bought a test, hurried back home, and rushed into the bathroom. I looked at the tiny screen, and it said if there were two lines, I was pregnant. If there was one, I wasn't pregnant. I hoped and prayed I would get those two lines. And sure enough, as I looked at the test, there were two lines. I was pregnant. I immediately burst out crying with joy. I was so thankful. I ran to tell my husband, and he was so elated, and we were so, so happy. Finally, we could start a family together. We rushed to get everything ready for the baby. We told our families at a huge dinner when we invited them all. We started preparing a room in the house for the baby. We painted it this lovely green color as we didn't know the gender yet. We started buying baby products like clothes, toys, and more. It was all so fun. My stomach got bigger and bigger, and we could feel the baby kicking around. I had to stop working because since I worked at this coal factory, I couldn't really move the equipment as well as I used to, and my husband and I agreed it would probably be best if myself and the baby didn't breathe in the fumes at the factory. This was a pretty tough decision, though, seeing as we didn't have much money and now we were losing another source of income. But it was the best for the baby, so we decided it was the right choice. I used this baby monitor machinery thing that I bought online that said it amplified the baby's heartbeat. We used it and we were so glad we could hear the baby. Its heart was beating so loudly and I started crying instantly when we used it. My family was so happy. My husband was so happy. Everything was right in the world. My husband and I also decided we wouldn't bother having doctor appointments throughout the pregnancy. For starters, they were incredibly expensive and we just didn't have the money. Secondly, we already had our own baby monitor device, the one we bought online, so we didn't need to worry. As long as we could hear the baby's heartbeat, everything would be fine. My due date was coming up, and we were so excited. I wondered what the gender of the baby was, but I didn't care either way. I would love it no matter what. But then, the due date came and went, and I hadn't given birth yet. My stomach was enormous by this point. I had been eating a lot because I heard you were eating for two people, right? Then a week after my due date, there was still no baby. We were starting to worry. We used the baby monitor device again, and we could still hear the baby's heartbeat, so it was fine. Maybe it was just taking its time to come out. We joked around that it liked staying in there too much. It didn't want to go out into the big wide world. More and more time passed, and then it came to 10 months. I was 1 month overdue. When would I give birth? Then, a year. We were really concerned and we searched online and it said sometimes pregnancies can last longer than 9 months. The world record for the longest pregnancy was 375 days. But my pregnancy soon surpassed that and we still had no baby. I was so worried. My belly was huge and there was no doubt in my mind that I was pregnant because our baby monitor proved we could hear the baby moving around. We could hear its heartbeat. But why had I been pregnant for so long? This was not right. It was universally known that a pregnancy lasted 9 months, right? So what was wrong with me? We used the baby heart monitor again, and the heartbeat was still going just as strong. So we decided we would trust our baby, let the baby decide when it wanted to come out. I also felt somewhat proud. I must be a really good mother considering the baby wanted to stay inside me. It must be really nice there. Time passed, and it was 1.5 years already. Our families were so confused, and we didn't know what to say or do or think. They told us we should go to the doctor, but we didn't have enough money to pay. We were barely affording to feed ourselves. Eventually, our family said I must have had a miscarriage. I must have lost the baby. I was so upset, and my husband and I told them not to say such a thing. We could hear the baby's heartbeat through the monitor. Of course I was pregnant, but they didn't believe us, so my husband and I decided to cut off ties with them. If they didn't believe us, then why should we bother speaking to them? Years passed. I got used to the big belly, and I just believed that my baby was taking longer than most to come out. I had been pregnant for 3 years. When would I give birth? But then I wondered, would that mean when I did eventually give birth, the baby would be 3 years old? That would be massive. I was so worried, and I told my husband we had to go to the doctors. I didn't care if we couldn't afford it. I was worried for the baby and my health too. How would I give birth to a baby the size of a three-year-old? We went to the doctors, and they hooked me up to a monitor. The doctor looked around on the screen and stayed silent for a while. But then she spoke up and told us I wasn't pregnant. I just had a big belly. We were shocked, to say the least. We almost didn't believe her. We told her about the baby heart monitor, the one we bought online. Just yesterday, we had done another scan, and it had played out our baby's heartbeat just as loudly as ever. Surely there was a baby inside me. But she explained those didn't always work. Sometimes they just played out heartbeats, even when there weren't any. What are you talking about? I cried out to the doctor. She nodded her head sadly. I'm sorry to have to tell you this, but it's true. You're not pregnant. Those baby heart monitors you bought were faulty. You should never buy something like that from some random online company. You can't always trust them. But you could always try to get pregnant again. But, started my husband, why does she have a big stomach then? The doctor looked uncomfortable. Well, that is just flesh. It's not from any baby. My mouth fell open in shock. So, this is just fat? The doctor nodded. I'm afraid so. But don't lose hope. Getting pregnant again is always an option. You should try. I nodded absentmindedly. I couldn't believe it. All this time, all 3 years, I had believed I was pregnant. But it turned out all of that was a lie. I was just fat. I started crying and my husband held me close. But then the doctor seemed to jump as something lit up on the monitor screen. She swiveled the mouse around frantically and scratched her head. What is it? I asked. The doctor didn't answer me, just called another doctor to come in. He walked into the room, smiled at us, and looked once again at the screen. My husband and I had no clue what was going on, but the doctors looked worried. Then one of them eventually addressed us. I'm sorry, miss, but you are in fact pregnant. I looked at him in alarm. What? But you said I wasn't. Our apologies. This is a very unusual case, you see. Never has there been a woman that has been pregnant for 3 years. So I have a baby inside of me? Well, no, you don't have a baby. I raised my hands in frustration. What are you talking about? Am I pregnant or am I not? The doctor nodded. You are pregnant, just not with a baby. So, the doctor took a deep breath. You're pregnant with three babies. You have triplets. My husband gasped, and I raised my hand at my mouth in surprise. Triplets? The doctors nodded, but there was more. She said, it seems you have been pregnant for 3 years, but the babies have been, how should I say this, dormant. What does that mean? It means they haven't grown at all in that three-year period. It seems you are fertilized, but your babies just haven't been growing. Well, what do we need to do? We suggest having surgery. We have methods of encouraging the babies into growth. If we succeed, you can expect triplets in 9 months. 9 months? Not three? Yes, 9 months. No, but wait, said my husband. We don't have enough money to pay for the surgery. Oh, about that, said the doctor. The U.S. government will no doubt provide funds for your operation. You see, this is a very special case. As far as we're concerned, this has never happened before in human history. I couldn't even really process what they were saying, but I was just happy to find out I really was pregnant, but with triplets. Oh, could we handle it? Thank you, I said. But what about funding for raising our triplets? We're poor people. I'm sure the government will help with that too. But in return, you will allow us to check in every now and then, just to make sure things are going smoothly. Of course. It was only a week later when the surgery was conducted. I was put under and they sent in some sort of chemical that activated the fetus and encouraged the babies into growth. When I woke up, my husband was there looking very worried, and the doctors told me everything had gone perfectly fine. Congratulations, they said. You are now officially pregnant. You can expect triplets in 9 months. I was crying with joy. Everything did work out fine in the end. It is now 2 years later. And yes, I did give birth to triplets in 9 months from that time. Two boys and one girl, all healthy, all beautiful. We named them Aiden, Alex, and Amy. They are now growing up into amazing children. And as it turns out, I got pregnant again. I now have a huge belly. And don't worry, we checked with the doctors. I am definitely pregnant. No dormant eggs. No 3-year pregnancy. I couldn't be more excited. You probably think I'm stupid for trusting that baby heart monitor from online, but when you have a heart monitor that tells you there's a baby inside you, you believe it. I guess we should have gone to the doctor sooner, but we were really poor. But I'm happy to say now that I am pregnant. Really, truly. The doctors performed a scan and showed us the image of our little girl. Now those can't be faulty. I'm due in 3 weeks, and we're so excited. Let's hope this doesn't turn out into another 3-year pregnancy. I open my eyes to find myself in a strange place. But because of the surroundings and equipment attached to me, I could tell that I was in a hospital. However, I had no idea how I got there, no matter how hard I tried to remember. And the most strange thing was that I couldn't move at all because of the things attached to me and because every part of my body hurt. She wakes up finally. Welcome back, a man in blue scrubs said as he saw me awake and asked the nurse nearby to take my vitals. He had a name tag with Ravi Patel, MD, written on it, so I thought he was the doctor. Do you know how you got here? The doctor started asking me questions. Not really, I said in a small, raspy voice. What's the last thing you remember doing? He asked again. But before we move on, like this video, hit that subscribe button, and activate the notification bell, and your parents will invite your lover over for dinner. Trust me, it works. I went to bed on Christmas Eve and woke up here, I replied, as that was exactly what I remembered. So the doctor took some notes and called in for my parents. They came in, both with tears in their eyes, and kissed my forehead. Then the doctor told them about how I remember going to bed on Christmas Eve and a few more things. But we only got to celebrate Christmas last year, my mom said to the doctor. After that, the doctor asked to see some scans of my head injury, examined it, and came to me and said, Flora, you were in a coma for 2 months because of a car accident. It seems you have retrograde amnesia because of that, since you have forgotten events of a whole year. After hearing what the doctor just said, my parents started acting strangely and asked to talk to the doctor somewhere else, and we went outside. Meanwhile, the nurse injected me with something, so I instantly fell asleep. Although I had gotten up from 2 months in a coma, the doctor said that I hadn't fully recovered, so I had to stay 5 more months in the hospital. During that time, none of my friends came to visit me, not even my best friend Sarah. We had been friends since elementary school, and she didn't even bother to at least call me at such a time of my life. That made me feel so bad, but I was grateful that my parents were there all the time, taking care of me, which made it easier. They made sure I had everything I needed. After 5 months, the doctor declared me fit to go home, and thus I was discharged. I couldn't remember a year of my life, and I had a lot of scars from the accident, but I was happy that I could finally go home as I was getting somewhat sick of the hospital. When I went home, too, my friends showed no effort to come and see me, or call or text. Even when I was the one calling or texting, they didn't return it. So a few days later, I decided that I would pay Sarah and a few of my other friends a visit. But I soon realized what a terrible idea it was. Some of my friends didn't even open the door for me, and some just asked me to leave as soon as they saw me. Finally, I went to Sarah's house and saw that she was sitting out on her porch going through her phone. But when she saw me coming, she instantly stood up to get inside. Hey, Sarah, wait up, I said, increasing my pace of the walk. She did stop and turned around, but what she said next completely broke my heart. Why are you here? I don't want to see your face. Just go away. She screamed in a way that the whole neighborhood could hear. I couldn't believe she could say that and be so rude to me. It hurt me so much that I turned around and ran off to my house crying. There were a lot of things going on in my mind. Did I do anything wrong to my friends in the year that I forgot about? I thought and tried to remember, but I couldn't. and the hurt just didn't end there. My parents showed me a letter that they received in the mail from my old workplace. It said that I had been laid off from the job and that I shouldn't expect a job there anytime in the future. I felt so low at that point, but then again, my parents were right there by my side trying to fix my mood and cheer me up. My dad was a business advisor who would often travel places to see for big companies, and that explained the money we had. And my mom had an antique shop right down the block from our house. So my mom brought up an idea that sounded pretty good to me. "Why don't you come and work with me at my antique shop?" she asked. And I immediately agreed, as I wanted to keep busy to forget the rude treatment of my friends and not get hurt. But as days passed by, I started noticing my parents were acting strange, especially my mother. She was so overprotective of me and wanted every detail of my whereabouts. And if I am even 1 minute late for my job, she would lose her mind, although it was only the shop and the house I went to. However, since I had been in an accident and a coma recently, and being their only child, the concern seemed reasonable. But then she would act even more strangely during the doctor's appointment. She would always pull the doctor aside and talk to him secretly. Once I even suspected if they were having an affair, but I knew it was all in my head, so I stopped thinking about anything in a negative sense. Like that, I stayed with my parents and worked at the antiques for 2.5 years. My parents were very happy, but I was getting more and more bored every day without any friends and nowhere else to go except for the house and the shop. So I decided that I would move to another city, but my only problem was convincing Mom and Dad. For that, one day at dinner, I brought up the topic about moving out. "Mom, Dad, I want to discuss something with you," I said. They immediately left the food they were eating and gave all their attention to me. "I want to move to another city and get a job I like and make some new friends," I said. And just as I had expected, they rejected. "Absolutely not. You are going to stay here safe at home," my dad said, and my mom agreed with him. "Please, stop treating me like I'm some porcelain doll. I want to live for a change and not just exist," I replied in a slightly louder tone. And as I was insistent and stubborn about it, my parents couldn't say or do anything that made me stay. Finally, I moved to another city and my parents helped me with the move, and I started living alone. But something changed after some days from the move. I started getting nightmares almost every night. In the nightmare, I would be in a car that would crash at the end of it. But the strange thing was, I wasn't alone in the car and the dream was blurry, so I couldn't figure out who it was. It bothered me a lot. Was there anyone with me during my crash? I thought, but then if there was, my parents would have told me. Still, I wanted to ask my parents about it, but I knew that if I let them know that I was having nightmares, they would leave everything they were doing and show up at my door in an instant, so I refrained from that. However, I was having a pretty good time with my new life in the new city. I loved my job and my workplace, and I had even made friends from there. We used to hang out twice every week, plus additional parties and brunches. There was a cute guy at work whom I had a huge crush on, and according to my friends at the office, he had a crush on me too. But I could never bring myself to talk to him, no matter how much my friends forced me to. I was not the one to make the first move, and he didn't try either, and later I heard he got together with his girlfriend from high school. After that, I didn't really get interested in anyone, so I stayed away from the dating life and stuck to my good life with friends and work. And just like that, with nightmares and my mom visiting me occasionally for the doctor's appointment, 2 years passed. One day I was returning to my apartment from work when suddenly I felt like someone was calling my name from behind. "Flora? Flora!" A guy came running towards me calling out my name as I was about to take the final turn. But I didn't know who he was, so I just ran towards my apartment. When I recall that event, I don't exactly know why I did that, but that was my instant reflex. After he saw that I was running, he stopped running behind me and walked the other way, and I also reached my apartment and locked the doors behind me. I was so relieved to get that stranger off my back and was a little tired too, so I went straight to bed. That night too, I was expecting the nightmare, but something different happened. I used to get the dream in all blur, but not that night. That night, I could clearly see the person that was with me in the car. It was the same guy who was running behind me during the day, only that he looked a little different. "What is going on?" I thought as I woke up from the nightmare. After so many years, my life was finally coming together, but a mystery knocked at my door all of a sudden. How was that guy in a car with me? However, I was not going to skip over it. I was determined to solve it and figure out what was going on. So for that, the next day, I didn't go to work. I went to the same turn where I had seen the guy the day before, as I didn't want to miss him even by seconds. I waited for hours and hours, but he didn't show up and I had to return to my apartment too, as it was getting dark. I felt a little bad, but I was determined. So the day after that too, I went to the same turn and waited for him. That day too, I waited and waited. I was almost sure that he wouldn't come, but right then I saw him coming from the opposite direction and he saw me. He rolled his eyes and came walking towards me and said, "Aren't you going to run today as if I'm about to mug you? I'm sorry, I didn't know you. And I don't know you, actually. Maybe you were there in the year I can't remember?" I said, "Yeah, Sarah told me about your condition." "I'm Evan, but why are you here now?" he asked. I was mad at the fact that Sarah would talk to some Evan guy about me, but ignore me completely. But I was not to get distracted, so I answered him with the details about my nightmare, about the crash, and how I saw him the night before in the dream. "Look, Flora, your parents threatened me to get out of town, whatever their reason was. So I think it is better that you ask them," he said. "And if you want to see me after you know everything, here's my number," he added, and gave me his number and left. What on earth? I was losing my mind over the things I didn't know, and the year I couldn't remember, and the fact that my parents kept it hidden from me for so long. I had had enough hide and seek with my own past, and I just couldn't do it anymore. So I went straight to the bus station from there and took a night bus to my hometown. It was very late when I reached home, so my parents were concerned about why I was there all of a sudden at such an hour. "Mom, without hiding anything, please tell me everything about what happened before the car crash. It has been haunting me since the day I woke up from the coma. Please, Mom," I said and started crying as I couldn't hold back my emotions. My mother's face went pale and she sighed. I should have had taken that as a signal to brace myself, because what she told me next tore me to pieces. "I'm sorry we kept it a secret from you, but you were in love with an irresponsible brat, Evan. You had met him during the New Year's Eve that year, and the night of the car crash, you guys were running away, as we disapproved of your relationship. In the crash, you got so hurt, which sent you to a coma while he got off with just a couple of bruises," she said. She told me that she and my dad both didn't like him, so to get him out of their life, they threatened him to go away, and even paid off my friends to not talk to me, so that I wouldn't have any source for details. "What? A boy is not an excuse to pay off my friends to not talk to me, Mom. And a crash doesn't mean you go and threaten someone," I screamed, as I was so mad at them. But that was just part of the disappointment. She told me that while my boyfriend and I were running away, I was pregnant, and that I lost the baby in the accident. The news came to me like someone broke a flower pot on my head. How could you keep that a secret from me for 5 years? I had the right to know I was pregnant, I said, and I started crying again as I was so hurt and disappointed. We were just trying to protect you from hurt, sweetheart, and do what was right for you, my mom replied, trying to sound innocent. And I knew her concerns were genuine, but I could never forgive them for hiding something like that from me. I was so heartbroken. But I tried to understand, thinking that was actually what they were trying to protect me from. But still, it wasn't fair to me, and I was not going to forgive them for that. "I know you have taken care of me, and I am very grateful. But you need to learn that you cannot protect me from everything," I said. I also told them that I didn't remember anything, but I wanted to make new memories with Evan and make them last this time. After that, I went to my room and texted the number Evan had given me, telling him I wanted to see him. Thanks for watching. What would you do if you forgot one whole year of your life? Let us know in the comments. Don't forget to subscribe and check out other videos on...
I've dated a lot of girls in my life, but when I finally met Megan, I believed I'd found the perfect girlfriend. I was in college at the time, and I met Megan in the library. We spotted each other from across the room, and it was love at first sight. She was so funny and beautiful. She had long locks of brown hair and sparkling green eyes. When I asked her out and she said yes, I couldn't believe it. We started dating, and I realized just how horrific my past relationships had been. Megan was always so easy to talk to, and she never got jealous like the other girls. She also gave me space to hang out with my other friends. She wasn't one of those girls that hung on to you every second of the day. I felt so lucky. I had found the perfect girlfriend. Or so I thought. But before I go on, don't forget to like and subscribe and click the notification bell for more crazy stories like this one. When Megan and I had been dating for around a month, things started to change. It started off small. Sometimes I would go to my closet and try to find my favorite red shirt, and it would be missing. I would look everywhere, but I couldn't find it. Other things started to go missing too. My earphones disappeared, even though I had sworn I'd seen them on the kitchen table just a minute ago. Some of the essays that I had written would disappear, even though they had been safely tucked into my folders. It didn't make any sense. Sometimes money would disappear from my wallet as well. I asked Megan, but she said she had no idea where they had gone. Weeks went by, and I soon forgot about my missing stuff. Then, I went to Megan's dorm room one day. I was in her bedroom, and she was outside chatting to some friends. I was standing beside her bed, and as I bent down to tie my shoelaces, I looked under her bed. What I saw made me gasp. All of my missing stuff was there. My favorite shirt, my earphones, my essays, my money. How on earth did it get there? Why did Megan have it? When Megan returned to her room, I confronted her about it. "Why do you have all my stuff?" I asked. "I have no idea," replied Megan. "Maybe someone found it and put it under there. Maybe someone's trying to frame me." She started to act scared and was fearful that someone was trying to sabotage her life. Being the sympathetic fool, I immediately tried to comfort her and tell her it was all right. What she was saying didn't really make any sense, but I trusted Megan, so I forgot about the missing stuff. You remember how I told you Megan would let me have time to myself? Well, after several weeks of dating, all that changed. She would start forcing me to be with her and hang out instead of studying. I had to spend every second of every day with her, even if I didn't want to. But she told me she missed me so much, so I believed and trusted her. But as I spent more and more time with her, and less time studying for college, my grades started to decline. But I had the perfect girlfriend, so I didn't mind sacrificing my grades if it meant I could stay with Megan. But then, sometimes I would be in my dorm with Megan and I would go to the bathroom for a second. I would come out and Megan would be on my computer, looking through all my files. She was really disregarding my privacy. But when I asked her what she was doing, she said she was just searching up something on Google, so I let it slide. As a couple, we would send pics to each other on our phones, and I would send a bunch of funny faces and embarrassing photos that I would prefer to stay between us. But then Megan would screenshot them. Joking, she would use it for blackmail. I laughed it off as well, but little did I know what she was capable of. Then, one night, something really scary happened. I was sleeping in my bed, and I thought I heard a noise. I woke up, heart beating fast, and I saw Megan sitting in a chair, just staring at me. I cried out in shock. I leaned over to turn my bedside lamp on, and when I turned back, she was gone. I asked Megan about it, but she said I must have been dreaming. It felt so real to me. But again, I trusted her, so I let it go. Then, something happened that was really weird. I was on my way to class, walking with a bunch of my friends, and people started staring at me strangely, and laughing and pointing at me. I had no idea what was going on. Then, one of my friends pulled out their phone and cried out. Some anonymous person had posted all of my embarrassing photos online. I was mortified. But the only person who had seen those photos was Megan. Surely, she wouldn't have leaked them. She was my girlfriend. She loved me, right? I was so confused. I didn't want to believe she would do that. Where had the perfect girlfriend I had fallen in love with all that time ago gone? I wanted her back. It was like one of those commercials on TV when they show you a product and it looks so amazing and attractive. But then when you actually get it, it turns out it's just a sloppy mess. I decided I had to ask Megan. I sent her a message and told her to meet me in the library, the place where we first met. When I got there, she was on the table, calmly reading a book. I stormed over to her and asked her about the photos. "How did this happen?" I asked in anger. But Megan just stayed silent and didn't speak. I kept talking to her, but she just looked at me blankly. "Why aren't you answering me? How did these photos get out?" I repeated. Again, all I received was silence. Then Megan stood up from her seat and just walked away. As if I hadn't said a thing. As if nothing was wrong. As if my entire life wasn't ruined by these leaked photos. To this day, I still remember that blank look on her face, and it still sends chills down my spine. I couldn't understand what was happening. What was wrong with Megan? She used to be the most perfect girlfriend. What happened? Then, I decided to confront her. I asked her what was wrong, and she finally revealed everything. My so-called perfect girlfriend wasn't who I thought she was. We were in my dorm room, and I pulled her onto my bed. No more lies, no more unanswered questions. I needed to know what was wrong. "What's happening, Megan? Why are you acting so strange?" I asked. Megan looked at me, then she rolled her eyes. I was shocked. I lifted my hands, moving to hug her, to figure out what was wrong. But she turned away from me as if I was revolting. I was so hurt. Why was she acting this way? A week ago, she had clung on to me like I was a life buoy. Why did she turn away from me now? "Get away from me," she snapped at me. I was so confused. "What? Why, Megan?" She scowled. "I'm not Megan, you idiot." My mind couldn't process her words. "What are you talking about?" Megan sighed, and then she brought her fingers to her eyes. I stared numbly at her as she seemed to dig into her eyes. She showed her hands to me, and I glanced at the eye contacts in them. I looked back up at her and was startled by her blue eyes, but she used to have green eyes. "What?" I mumbled. Then Megan sighed again and grabbed at her hair. I cried out in surprise as her hair fell off, revealing the blonde hair beneath it. She had been wearing a wig all this time and green eye contacts. But why? What was the point? Then I looked at her more closely, and everything made sense. As it turned out, her real name wasn't Megan. It was Sarah, my ex-girlfriend from high school. My mind recalled memories of Sarah, my ex-girlfriend from high school who was blonde and had blue eyes. She was sitting right in front of me. But why was she here? Why had she disguised herself and dated me? "Sarah!" I cried out. "Oh, now you remember me," she said. I gasped. "But why? Why did you do this?" Sarah looked at me with hatred. "Because you were a terrible boyfriend. You always treated me badly, and I needed revenge." "So you leaked the photos?" "Yeah, and I did steal that stuff, you imbecile. I can't believe you didn't realize it." I trembled under the realization that Sarah had changed her identity to get revenge on me and had used her cover as my girlfriend to sabotage my life. Because of her, my reputation was ruined. My grades had fallen, and I was broke. I couldn't believe it. Had I really treated her that badly? Was I really a terrible boyfriend? I tried to remember that one year in high school when I had dated her. I was a different man back then. I was probably known as the school bully. I guess I had been mean to her sometimes. I remember calling her names like Stinky Sarah. Or I remember in class when I had spread the rumor that she had 7 toes on 1 foot. If you ask me why I did horrible things like that, I wouldn't know what to say. Maybe it was just me acting up with my weird teenage hormones. I don't know, but was it really worth plotting revenge against me? Putting all this effort into deceiving me? Besides, I was a different person now. I was kind. I respected women. Couldn't she see that? I had changed. But then Sarah spoke up. "I guess the gig is up. So here's the deal. If you don't apologize to me and admit you were a terrible boyfriend, I'm going to leak even more photos, some of which you really don't want getting out. Trust me." I relented. "Fine," I said. "I'm a terrible boyfriend." Sarah smiled evilly. "And you suck." I sighed. "And I suck." That's all I needed to hear. She stood up, walked out of the room, and I never saw her again. Well, not in person at least. I was in my last year of college and I was watching the news one day when Sarah's face popped up on screen. Except this time, she had neither blonde nor brown hair. She had jet black hair, and it was cut in a bob. She was also wearing dark brown eye contacts. I was shocked by her appearance, but nothing shocked me more than the anchorman when he said she was in prison. She had been involved in a bank robbery and had stole over $1 million. The police had caught her and she would be serving a sentence of 6 years. I was somewhat relieved as I wouldn't have to worry about seeing her for another 6 years. But I was also saddened by how she had turned out. She was a maniac. Was it because of me? Is that why she acted so crazy? Had her hatred and revenge for me driven her insane? And then I started to fear for the future. What about when she was released from prison? What if her time spent there just fueled her hatred towards me? What if she came out wanting to seek revenge again? I still don't know. I still haven't seen Sarah. I'm not sure what was wrong with her. But one thing's for certain. Sarah, Megan, whoever she was one crazy girlfriend. And she wasn't the perfect girlfriend I had initially believed her to be.